Good evening. So good to see everybody here tonight. A few announcements before we start. I'm going to ask Brother Jared Oselta to lead us in opening prayer and Brother Gary Barrett to lead us in closing prayer. And Gary, if you would please remember to bless the offering whenever you lead closing prayer. On our sick list, Donna Elkins has been moved to Tenova Rehab. She's there for a little while for therapy on her heart and stuff to get her built back up. But she's going to be there for a little while and then hopefully be moving home from there. Craig Howell had surgery. A lot of you know he only has one good arm because of things that happened back when he was a child. And this was surgery to replace his entire shoulder on his good arm. So he is kind of down and out right now. Really needs the prayers, so please keep him in your prayers. Also, Brother Barry Howell wasn't feeling well this morning. But as far as good news goes, Brother Philip Batson was back with us this morning after having his stroke. He is doing better, so we're glad that he was back also. Also, please remember my mom in your prayers. She has surgery this coming Friday on her leg. They're going to be stripping some veins out of her leg to hopefully heal the ulcer that's on her leg. She's having a lot of problems with that and a lot of pain. So please remember her in your prayers. Let's see. We have a wonderful announcement. We have a new sister in Christ. Sister Shauna Clary was baptized, I believe that was Monday. And we're so glad to have her with us. So glad to have the girls with us also. And bless her heart, she's married to Dylan. So she's got a long road to hoe. But, you know, I think she can handle him and stuff. Dylan I've known him all his life. And he's a sweetheart. Him and my nephew got into things. But they were boys. So it was just to be expected. So, but anyways, we welcome you to our family. Got an announcement about some changes in our services. Beginning next Sunday, we will be consolidating our services into one morning service at 10 o'clock. Everybody will be coming together then at 10 o'clock. There will not be a Sunday evening service. And then starting on July the 8th, we will begin our summer series on Wednesday nights. We'll be having different preachers through the month of August, right, Bobby? Through the month of August, we'll be having different speakers on Wednesday nights. Like I said, that begins July 8th, so please remember that. Starting next Sunday, we will be asking that if you are in attendance, to please wear a mask. Please wear a face mask to help prevent the spread of the coronavirus. We will be giving out masks here at the building. We will have those available for you. And there will still be no Bible classes on Sunday or Wednesdays for right now. So please remember that, and that begins next Sunday. I've got a card to read. It says, you have a unique way of making others feel truly cared about. Hope you know how appreciated you are. You don't know how much prayers, cards, and phone calls mean to someone until you're on the receiving end. Thank you so much for being there when I needed you, Philip Batson. So, Brother Philip wanted to let us know how much he appreciated us. And also, we have a bridal shower that's going to be coming up. It says you're invited to a bridal shower for Shayla Neal, Sunday, July 12th, from 3 to 5 at the Dover Church of Christ. Bride and groom registered at Bed Bath & Beyond and Amazon. Given by Maid of Honor, Cilla Neal, and friends. So please remember that. July 12th, 3 to 5, bridal shower for Shayla. Congratulations to her. I think that's everything for right now. And we didn't have any birthdays or anniversaries, so we'll have our opening prayer at this time. Our first song will be A Wonderful Savior. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, and covers me there with his hand, and covers me there with his hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord, he taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up and I shall not be moved, he giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, and covers me there with his hand, and covers me there with his hand. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, and covers me there with his hand, and covers me there with his hand. Our next song will be Great is Thy Faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their chorus above, join with all To thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Our hymn to help us prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper will be I Stand Amazed.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. When with the ransomed in glory his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
At this time, I ask that you put away all worldly thoughts as we go to our Father in prayer and thank him for the sacrifice that was made. Would you bow with me while we give thanks for the bread? Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we're indeed thankful for all life's blessings. We're thankful at this time for that great and ultimate sacrifice, your only begotten Son. As we partake of this bread, we pray that we do so in a worthy manner that's pleasing and acceptable in your sight, Lord. We ask that you be with us as we take this and everything we do in a manner of spirit and in truth, Father. We thank you for this bread. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you bow with me again as we give thanks for the cup? In like manner, Heavenly Father, we come bowed before you, thanking you for this cup, which represents the precious blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Again, as we partake of it, we pray that we do so in a worthy manner that's pleasing and acceptable in your sight, and that we worship you in a manner of spirit and truth, Lord. We humbly say we love you. Again, we thank you for this sacrifice and thank you for this cup. In Jesus' blessed name we pray. Amen.
Our next song will be Years I Spent in Vanity. If you would please stand while we use this song. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the law I'd spurned, till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary.
Please be seated.
Good evening. Welcome you back tonight. We are glad that you're here. Thankful for the presence of everyone. Appreciate Jeff leading us in songs. Does a good job for us. We are very, very thankful for that. Jared, the prayer was awesome. You do a good job, bud. We're proud of all of our young people. Very, very intelligent young mind that graduated a year ago, and we're thankful that that we had so many great ones that have come out of our youth group here recently and who continue to be faithful and help to participate and lead us in worship service. It does the rest of our hearts good to see our young people continue to do that. As Jeff mentioned, Wednesday night, not July the 1st, but as he said, July the 8th, We'll begin our Wednesday night summer series that we have planned here. Originally, we were going to be doing it the months of June, July, and August, and recent events took a turn for us, and that wasn't able to happen, but we're looking forward to that starting in July. And so in July and August, it's basically going to be like a once-a-week gospel meeting that we have. It's going to continue over those 2 months. I'm really excited about the speakers. I'm excited about the topics that we have lined up, because I've simply given them the direction of presenting a sermon under the title, If I Only Had One Last Sermon to Preach. And I think that's going to be interesting. Giving guys that are as talented as the ones that we have come in a title like that, it's going to make for a great series. And so I'm very, very excited about that. And then we have, as he mentioned, we're headed in the direction to getting back to where we want to be, and that process is unfolding. And so a temporary step, a temporary measure to begin that is us coming together. You notice when we usually would come in here on Sunday night, we had the pews sectioned off and taped, and it was every other pew, and you'd come in here and you'd notice that the tape was all down and hanging on the floor. It wasn't because we had junk tape, was it, Chris? No. Our at-risk service, our older people who we designed to be here at 10 o'clock at risk, apparently you don't tell them where to sit. They come in, rip the tape off, sit where they want, usually piled up together anyway, most of them not wearing masks in the at-risk category. And so we're going to go ahead and bring everybody in together and look out for them, because they will sit where they want to sit, apparently. And so we're excited to get back at that and be back together and then as quickly as possible moving forward, even beyond that, as we're able to graduate into some different levels of us being together. We're also going to, just when this thing had begun a few months ago, we had just gotten our youth devotionals fired up and going, and that was going great. And we're going to get those rolling again also. We have some things planned for our young people. And so next Sunday night, we're inviting the middle school and up group of our young people to our house. We're going to have a youth devotional at my place, and if you want to be a part of that, you're welcome to come. If you're worried about my snotty kids, it's not the place for you. But we do invite you to be a part of that. Parents are invited also, as always, and we look forward to getting that and some other things rolling just as quickly as we possibly can. One of the most dearly needed human qualities in our society today, and Jared mentioned some things about the world in which we live in his prayer, and he was exactly right, but because of what we see around us, one of the most desperately needed qualities in our world is the quality of a person who loves mercy, a person who loves mercy. And apparently, that is not a new dilemma. It's not a new problem that's something that is lacking in society, because thousands of years ago, the prophet Micah in Micah chapter 6 and verse 8 told the people of his day, who were going through some of the religious motions, but their hearts were not where they needed to be, he had to tell them, he has shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? And you remember we looked at this verse beginning last week. What did the Lord require of them? Well, he mentions three things here: to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Last week we noticed or brought attention to the fact that there are three things there that the Lord requires of everybody. He required it back in the day of Micah, and you better believe he requires it in our day right now. Last week we looked at the first of those, to do justly. In other words, you got to be fair with yourself, fair with your fellow man, and fair with God. You got to be just in your dealings of all of your responsibilities and situations of life. What are the three things? Well, that's one of them: justice and mercy and Lord's will. Next week when we come together, we're going to talk about the idea of a desperately needed quality of humility. But for tonight, we need to love mercy. We need to love mercy. And we'll unfold what's involved in that here in just a moment, because for today, God's people need to be concerned about this. We need to be people who care about loving mercy, because a person that has a heart that loves mercy is a person that has a heart that loves their fellow man. And a person who has the quality of loving mercy is a person who is interested in loving God. It really is a cornerstone to so many other things and so many other qualities that we need to develop. I heard a story about a person from many, many, many years ago, back when healthcare was obviously not where it is today. But this person was out doing some work on the farm, and maybe they had been hunting. I'm not sure what caused it to happen. But this person got sliced up, got tore up bad by some wild hogs. They got a hold of him, tore up his legs. And it just so happened that at least one of the ones that got to him was a rabid hog. And so he was diagnosed with having a severe condition of being infected with rabies. The doctors got to him as quickly as they could. They bandaged him up. They stitched him up. But they let him know that for him, there was not going to be a treatment for that. That he was going to deteriorate quickly, and that as a result, he was going to die. And get your house in order. It's time to get serious. You need to get some final arrangements made while you still have your life in your hands. And so the doctor gave him that very, very grave message. Get things in order. And the doctor left him to his thoughts. After some time, the doctor went back in on him to check on his fever and to check on the bandages and to see how he was doing. And he noticed that the man was there and had pen and paper and was just furiously scribbling out on the paper and writing and writing. And the doctor noted that and said, "Listen, I'm glad that you took what I said very, very seriously. I'm glad you're getting things in order. I'm glad that you're making what appears to be your last will and testament, because this is serious." And the man looked up from his sick bed and said, "I'm not making my will." And he said, "Well, what are you doing?" He said, "I'm writing out a list of people that I plan on biting before I die." All right. Well, unfortunately, that's the way that some people are in our world. Some people live by the philosophy of don't get mad, get even. Do whatever you have to do. Take out your frustrations on others. Treat others in a very, very unkind and a way that does not love mercy. But you know, without mercy, we couldn't make it through this life. And you better believe that without mercy, we would have zero chance when it comes to eternal life with God in heaven. We are absolutely fundamentally dependent on the fact that God loves mercy for us one day getting to where we need to be. We need the mercy of other people. We'll talk about that tonight. We are indebted to those around us who have been people who love mercy for us along the way. And especially we need the mercy of God. Let's start by kind of defining some terms. What is mercy? Well, we need to understand two things about it. It is a heart condition. It is an attitude. And it is an attitude that is going to be reflected in the way that you behave. And so it's an attitude that shows up in actions. An attitude that shows it's not just a heart condition, it's something that you do. And it's not just something that you go through the motions of doing, it's something that you're doing from the right heart. And so it's got to be a combination of those. It's what makes each one of us have the capability of being kind to another person. It's what allows me to not be so critically and harshly judgmental of the people who are around me. It's that quality that allows me to look for the best in another person. You know, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 13, and I believe it's verse 7 or 8, when it comes to what the Bible says about love there, that love believes all things. And we've talked about that phrase before when we studied that great chapter on love. But what does that mean? If you remember, love believes all things. The idea behind that phrase is, if you've got this quality in your heart, then you will believe the best possible about another person. You don't jump to automatically thinking the worst possible about a person. You have the best possible thing in your mind. I have the responsibility before God, when I'm making a judgment about another person, that I will believe the best about them until proven otherwise. Now, unfortunately, we often do the opposite. We believe the worst until that's proven untrue, when we've got to believe the best possible until it's proven otherwise. That's a part of what we mean And that's a part of what Micah would have had in mind when he told his audience, this is what the Lord requires of you, that you be a people who love mercy. And so I guess when we read through the Bible, and I think about reading through the New Testament, and I come to some of the great teachings of our Lord, which he did in the form of parables, I can't think of a better example. Before we get into a little outline here tonight, I can't think of a better example as far as defining some terms here of what it means to love mercy than what you find in the parable of the Good Samaritan. You remember in that parable that a man had fallen among thieves, and the Bible depicts him as basically being beaten, robbed, and left for dead. Just dropped right there on the side of the road. A human being. And you remember that a priest and a Levite come by, both religious people, both selected because people know that about them and would expect that if they're religious people, they would do something about it. They did not. They passed by on the other side. They saw a sad situation. They didn't love mercy. They had other things on their mind, and they went about their business. But then we remember that of all people, a Samaritan comes through, and he was a person who loved mercy, wanted to help. Now, how did he do that? He didn't look at this man on the side of the road and say, my thoughts are with you, good luck. He didn't walk on by and shake his head and say, boy, that's awful. I hope things work out for him, and then just keep on rolling. He went beyond that. He recognized, he was touched by what he saw, he loved mercy, he got down and he nursed the wounds of that man, nursed his wounds, took him to a place where the man could recover, and then even went beyond that and paid his expenses so that he could heal up, covered him. There are things that pass before our eyes. And if we're people who love mercy, it ought to have an effect on us. There are things that I have seen that were brought to my attention this week of people who have been severely hurt on another continent, and it was brought to my attention, these are our brethren. And I hadn't even thought about it like that. That's my family. Members of the Lord's church who are suffering dearly because of their faith in other parts of our world. And how many times have I seen things like that scrolled on by, priest or the Levite, and did nothing, wasn't even touched by it. And so true mercy is being extended. That's what we see with the Good Samaritan. And really the Good Samaritan is a beautiful picture of Jesus Christ who told that remarkable story. He's the perfect example of all things. Even the lawyer who posed the question to begin with, who is my neighbor, even he had to recognize what just happened. Now, he probably too proud or didn't want to actually say the word Samaritan himself because of his prejudices. When asked which of them was a neighbor to him, he said, well, he who showed mercy. He didn't use his name. He should have given credit. But even at that, he shows us a great thing, and that is that mercy has got to be displayed. The one who showed mercy, you've got to love it. You have to love mercy. And so it's still true today that we've got folks, here's how I want to apply it. We've got folks who fall by the wayside. They may not necessarily have been... You're not necessarily going to go down the streets of Dover and find somebody who got mugged, beaten, and left for dead. That's probably not going to happen. But we do pass people every day, and you may very well have passed someone walking down the aisle today who has fallen by the wayside. They've been beat up by life. They have been victimized by the sin in their lives, and they are in desperate need of somebody to show them some mercy. They are around us every day. They're probably sitting among us right now. Somebody who is guilty of sin, and what is my temptation? My temptation, unfortunately, many times, is to expose in a very calloused way the wrongdoing. Well, old Van got what he deserved finally. All right? Or whoever, put their name in the blank. We want to expose it. We want to punish the wrongdoer. Finally, that, you know what? It all caught up with them. Somebody kind of says with a smirk. They are on the wayside. They have been beaten up by life. And that's the best we got. If that's the best I got, that's a sad situation. I mean, we really want to dig in on whatever crime it is that they have committed to get them in the sad situation that they're in. When, what would be a better question? Maybe it would be better if I would start by asking, I wonder how they got there. I wonder what led the person to get themselves in the situation that they're in. And start to try to understand and start to try to have a little bit of compassion so that I can be a person who loves mercy for the people around me who have fallen by the wayside. And maybe even more importantly, what do I have to do to bandage up their wounds? They look a lot different than the guy who was left on the wayside in the parable in the New Testament. But they're beat up. They're hurt. They're wounded. What do I need to do? What is my responsibility to get down on their level, to help to bandage their needs, and then get them to where they need to be? That might be a much, much better way to look at it. You see, the person who loves mercy, they're not so much concerned about condemnation and really digging in and sticking it to them and letting them know you really finally got what you deserve. They're not concerned about condemnation. They're concerned about restoration. How can I help? What can I do for you? Let's never forget that idea when we think about, well, when we think about the character of God, the nature of God. God would have, and we talked about this last week on the justice of God, He would have been entirely justified had He not forgiven man for his sins. That was the punishment. The wages of sin is death. You go back, in the day that you eat thereof, you will surely die. And He would have been entirely justified had He brought that punishment upon man. But in the person of Jesus Christ and His sacrifice, God chose instead to forgive. And that was a demonstration of what it looks like to love mercy. And that's my example. With all of that in mind, how can I, as a child of God, how can we together as a family of God be better about having this second quality that the Lord requires of us? Being a people who love mercy. And folks, I don't know anybody who doesn't need this lesson. We all need it. And it starts right here. I told him this morning, I felt like I do with a lot of them, I felt guilty writing this sermon. Because I'm preaching on something that I'm not real good at and that I got a lot of work to do. And so it starts right here. It starts with all of us. I need it. You need it. All of us know that it is it's easy to criticize. It is very, very easy to just cast judgment and look the other way. It's easy to be skeptical. It's easy to jump to conclusions about why somebody made the decision that they did. How can I change my attitude? This is an attitude that's demonstrated in an action. It starts in my heart. How do I change my heart on this? How do I become more of a person who loves mercy? Let me share some ways tonight. We're going to love mercy. That means we must remember a few things. And number one, we must remember that we needed it first. It starts right here. How can I love mercy? By remembering that I needed it first. I was in desperate need of this help. If we'll stop and think about that person that we want to judge, that person that we want to be very, very harshly critical of, maybe somebody who's even harmed us in some way. Not just some situation that I'm not touched by and I see somebody else who's hurt, but I got tangled up in it too, in whatever way. If we would only stop and think, wait a minute, you know what? I've hurt people too. A lot. I've disappointed people too. I've let people down too. And I look at my past and I recognize I've needed mercy too. And I'm very, very thankful for every time that it was shown to me, because I've needed it. Think about the debt that I owed the Lord. My sin debt. He forgave me of that because He loved mercy. There is nothing that anybody can ever do to me that is worse than what I did to God. There's no kind of debt that can be piled up next to that. I want you to remember, if you have your Bible, let's go over to Galatians chapter 6. We'll leave Micah 6 just for a moment. Go over to Galatians 6. And remember that by inspiration, the church is told this. Brethren, if anyone is overtaken in a trespass or a fault, depending on your translation, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Why should I help to restore somebody, number one? And number two, why should I do that while maintaining a spirit of meekness, humility about myself? Why is that? Very simply this. Because next week, it could be me. Next week, it could be me. They messed up. They sinned. Maybe it's not even them. Maybe it's someone's family, their children, or somebody's grandchildren who did something or got caught up in something. And then this week, I'm looking at it and saying, well, I would never have done such a thing. Or this statement that I'll try not to make in my life, my kids would never. Just as soon as I say it, one of these guys is going to make me look bad, all right? Or I'll do it first to make them look bad, whatever it might be. But how many times are people guilty of that? They see someone else's children and they immediately think, well, I would never, or we would never. Next week it could be you that is caught up in some kind of trauma, entangled in some kind of, embroiled in some kind of mess. And then I spent the previous time harshly being critical of everybody else and their decisions and how I would never, and now here I am. How do I expect that people are going to treat me? Now that I'm the one who needs mercy. Restore such a one in the spirit of meekness. And so when I consider a brother who is beat up alongside the road, spiritually speaking, overtaken in a fault, what do? I love mercy and I help him back up. I've got to do better about this. You mercifully help him to make that right. And you do it compassionately because you got to remember next week he might be the one helping you. I've got to know that. How do I want to be handled? How would I want to be treated? I need to show that first. And so the first thing we need to do if we want to be people who are individuals who love mercy, we got to remember how much mercy has been bestowed upon us. I am thankful for every second chance that I have ever been granted in life. And I've been given a lot more than just second chances. I am very, very grateful for them. There are so many out there who need a helping hand. God has been merciful to me. How dare I take that away from somebody else and not be willing to show it? How are we going to be a people who love mercy? We got to remember that it started right here and I needed it first. And I'm thankful for it, and that'll help me to be more merciful toward others. Number two, it would be helpful to getting to that quality of loving mercy if we would be less harshly and critical and condemning in our judgments of others. To be less judgmental. I am, to be honest about it, embarrassed to say this, but there have been times when I have been very unfairly judgmental and critical of other people. And that is embarrassing. But I think we've all been there. Maybe someone talked differently than me in whatever way. And I automatically jumped to a conclusion about that person before I even got to know them. And I've automatically jumped to a conclusion. Maybe they dress differently than me. And I automatically start judging. Maybe they looked differently than me. Or a host of other things that you could put on that list with the word differently. And rather than being a person who loved mercy, I started casting judgment. I don't want to be like that. I don't want people to be that way toward me. And then when I allowed myself to get to know that person, open my heart up to them, I learned very quickly that I judged way too quickly. And that is embarrassing. People that I came to appreciate, people that are still my genuinely good, solid, loyal friends, and I was almost guilty of not giving them a chance because I didn't get this second point. We can do better than that. What had I done? I initially, for whatever reason, didn't get acquainted with them, didn't let them in, because I made a judgment before I even got to know who they were. And so from time to time, we misjudge people. We don't try to know what their situation was really like. We look at an outward appearance and cast judgment on the heart, and we have no business doing that. We're bad about it. You know, I'm very, very proud of a new little device that I've got, trying to get up to speed, Van, and you're slowly getting me there, but we'll get there. But I have an Apple Watch, all right? I can message you. You can call me on it. Don't even need my phone anymore. I'm learning how to text on it. That's been a bit tricky. Stores pictures, whatever. It may take pictures. I don't know. I don't know what all it does yet. But it does this also. It counts my steps. And so I've been a lot more diligent. And it actually insults me along the way. I'll get my watch will buzz, and I'll look down, and it'll say, normally, you're more active than you have been today. Is something wrong? Right? My heart rate is up for whatever reason. I'm at a ball game, and it'll say, perhaps you need to take a moment to breathe. Breathing is good, and then it'll tell me all of these different qualities that I need. And they're linked up. It's linked up with other people, so now I'm also competitive because I can't let anybody in my world get more steps than me. And someone was harassing me about my progress the other day. It's been a few days now, and I let this woman know that she would have more calories burnt if her watch would count jumping to conclusions. Right? Well, you know what? If jumping to conclusions was a physical activity, there are a lot of people who'd be in pretty good shape. All right. Well, we have to understand that we are bad about that activity. The only exercise some folks get is jumping to conclusions, I'm afraid. It's interesting to me when you consider the Church of Christ and how God puts so many different people and so many different personalities together, and then what does He do? He says, y'all work it out. Learn to get along. Love each other. Look around you at this room. We got people from different regions who maybe lived in different places and different personalities and different methods of being raised. And, you know, some of y'all are hard to get along with, all right? But you recognize that I that's a little bit of self-deprecating humor right there. But God takes all of these unique personalities and He says, y'all learn to get along. Learn to love each other. Different backgrounds, different personalities. Look at what the Bible says in Ephesians, the 4th chapter. Great chapter on unity in many ways, but regarding this point, look at Ephesians 4 and verse 2, where it tells us, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love. We studied that verse before. It's a beautiful thought. Forbearing one another in love. What does that mean? It means you put up with each other. You put up with each other. It means we got different backgrounds, personalities. God puts us all in one family, one body, and He says, now learn to love. Why is that important? Because if I can't get it right here in my church family, I most certainly am not going to get it right when I go out into the world and I need to show that quality toward other people. We practice it, we learn it right here. And then with evangelism, we begin to carry it out to the people around us. In the family of God, we learn to put up with one another. And then we carry that into the world because we've learned how to do it when it comes to the church. Y'all are probably a lot better at this because of me. I know that I can not always be the most easy person to handle, right? But I'm thankful that I can still call you my friends. Don't talk about me, Van. I am thankful that that despite our unique and sometimes challenging and difficult personalities, that we got a place to call home, that we've got a family that we can come home to, and it's a great relationship that exists. The only way we can ever be forbearing one to another is if we're a people who love mercy. We have to be less judgmental. And so if we want to love mercy, what do? I start by remembering that I needed it first. I'm thankful for it, and I better be showing that gratitude by displaying it toward other people. I remember, number two, that I need to be more careful about just jumping to conclusions and harshly critical and being very, very judgmental toward those around me. It'll help me to be a person who loves mercy more. And let me also say along with that, that if we are going to love mercy, we must remember to look to the example of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, our Lord, we look at Him and we know that He was perfect in every, absolutely every way. No flaws. Sinlessly perfect. My example, my perfect example in all things. Every aspect of life. You better believe He always loved mercy. He loved mercy. On the cross, think for a moment about Calvary. They shouted at Him, "If you're the Son of God, why are you still up there?" If. They are ridiculing and mocking and laughing at Him as He dies for them. And they do it by saying, "If you're who you claim to be, why don't you just come down?" Must not be who He claimed to be. They had a lot of fun at His expense. You see, they thought that it was a handful of physical nails that kept Him on the cross. They looked at Him, they failed to see Him for who He was, and they thought that He was just another person suspended by nails and without power to do anything about it. So they made fun of Him, while also spitting on Him, mocking Him, beating Him, slapping Him, insulting Him, scourging Him, ultimately crucifying Him. And the best they could do is look at Him and laugh and say, "Why don't you put a stop to it? Why don't you do something about it?" Why did He stay there and die? Because He loved mercy. It had nothing to do with nails. He stayed there because He loved mercy. And it was that mercy that allowed Him to endure everything that we just talked about and more than we could ever imagine, and look at those people and then say to God, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." And because of it, every one of us have the opportunity for salvation because He loved mercy that much. When we look at the mercy that Christ has extended to us, I need to be a more merciful person. Say something kind, do something good. You never know what kind of lasting impact you're going to have on a life when you help to heal up somebody who has been beat up by life. The greatest need that any of us have is for the mercy of God. We remind ourselves when we come together, that can be yours, and it's not going to be yours if you don't show mercy yourself. Don't expect for it to come your way if you've been unwilling to show it to somebody else. Maybe you are someone who is here and is ready to receive the mercy of God. His mercy triumphed over His justice, and He allowed for us a plan by which we could be saved despite ourselves and despite our sin. He loved mercy. His justice was satisfied in the sacrifice of Jesus for me and for you. And He provides for us a plan where we can come back to a relationship with Him and be forgiven in the blood. It happens every time somebody obeys the gospel. They put Christ on in baptism. Romans 6, 3 and 4 lets us know that's how I come in contact with His death. You're baptized to come into contact with His death. It gives you the remission, the washing away, the forgiveness of your sins. Thank God that He loves mercy. He gives me a chance. You get that mercy every time you need to come back home, and He welcomes you with open arms. So if you've been away from home, the greatest need you have is that God loves mercy. A group of little children were about to participate in a race. And it was a unique group. It was an awesome group. We've got some young people in this room right here, several of them, who have helped with this group. Because we got some really good young people in here who have helped whenever our children in town go and participate in the Special Olympics. Make great grades, do awesome things, be athletic, that's all well and good. But I catch our young people here helping out with activities like that, and that's, you've just won my heart. I'm thankful for it. But this group was about to start. They entered the race, and they began, and they took off. And one of these, to the best of their ability, and one of them fell and got banged up pretty bad. Scratched up, bleeding, crying, was excited to be there and just got hurt. And without anybody having to stop them and tell them or instruct them, all of the rest of the little ones who had entered that race stopped, went to the one who fell and got hurt, picked him up, helped him dry off his eyes, dusted him off, and they walked together to the finish line. What a beautiful heart. There was a time when one looked down from heaven and he saw a fallen humanity that needed help. And he came to my rescue. He dusted me off, picked me up, and said, we'll get there together. That's a God who loves mercy. A God who wants you to be saved. The opportunity is ours every time we come together, including right now as together we stand and sing.
All things are ready. Come to the feast. Come, for the table now is spread. Ye famishing, ye weary, come, and thou shalt be richly fed. Hear the invitation, come whosoever will, praise God for full salvation, for whosoever will. All things are ready. Come to the feast, come, for the door is open wide. A place of honor is reserved for you at the Master's side. Hear the invitation, come whosoever will. Praise God
for full salvation, for whosoever will. All things are ready, come to the feast, leave every care and worldly strife. Come feast upon the love of God and drink everlasting life. Hear the invitation, come whosoever will. Praise God for full salvation, for whosoever will. Thank you for being here tonight. One more time, Gary, please don't forget to bless the offering. Our closing hymn will be, I Want to Be Ready to Meet Him. You may have your worldly pleasures, your silver and your gold. You may pile up all the riches that this old world can hold. But I'd rather have my Savior and with Him firmly stand. For I want to be ready to meet Him in the glory land. I want to be ready to meet Him by and by. I want to be ready to meet Him in the sky. Oh, I want to be more like Him and do His blessed command. For I want to be ready to meet Him in the glory land. You may talk about your riches, your diamonds and your pearls. You may gain the wealth for ages of this and all the worlds. But the Savior is more precious, with Him I'll take my stand. For I want to be ready to meet Him in the glory land. I want to be ready to meet Him by and by. I want to be ready to meet Him in the sky. Oh, I want to be more like Him and do His blessed command. For I want to be ready to meet Him in the glory land. There is one thing I can boast of, salvation from the fall. I'm an heir to wealth and glory, my Father owns it all. That is why I'm shouting happy and go at His command. For I want to be ready to meet Him in the glory land. I want to be ready to meet Him by and by. I want to be ready to meet Him in the sky. Oh, I want to be more like Him and do His blessed command. For I want to be ready to meet Him in the glory land.